Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. Man, it's good to see everybody this morning. We welcome you to HCC. Whether you're here in the room with us or if you're visiting, watching online, we welcome you as well. If you are new to HCC, or maybe you just like some more information, or you'd like to know how you can get better connected, I invite you to, before you leave today, visit the connection point out front. There's someone be happy to talk to you and help you take care of that. Also, if you would prefer to text, you can text the word welcome to our church number, 740-303-7898, and someone will be glad to get back with you that way as well. This Thursday is the 2021 Central Ohio Men and Boys Bean Dinner. I know a lot of you guys in this room have been to one of those before in your life. It's been going on for over 60 years now. And again, that's this Thursday, March 18th. All men and boys, all ages are invited. It's a great way to invite somebody else to come with you. The only change this year is it is beanless, which would be a little weird for the bean dinner. But yeah, many of us are not disappointed in that at all. So, looking forward to April 4th, that's Easter Sunday. That'll be a great time to come and celebrate the empty tomb. And we look forward to that. Again, we'll have the same two times for our services on Easter, 9 and 10:30. Both services are identical. So if you're someone whose schedule allows, you don't have young kids and whatnot, maybe you prefer to come to 9 o'clock. It may be a little less crowded than the 10:30. But either way, either in person or online, we certainly invite you to join us for that special day on April 4th. And before we get started this morning, I ask everyone to rise to your feet. Let's go to God in prayer this morning. Father God, we thank you for the beautiful sunshine outside. Thank you for everything you've created. Thank you for creating us. Thank you for Jesus, and thank you for loving us despite all of our imperfections. Father, you are the only one that's truly worthy of our praise and our worship, and I pray that our praise and our worship will be pleasing in your sight this morning. I ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
You are, you'll be forever. rejoice with Jesus face to face. Sing about that encounter with him this morning. Wonderful thing it is to think about our anticipation of spending eternity with the Father, gathered with the saints and the angels, worshiping around his throne. But you know, this morning on this side of heaven, we have that same opportunity to gather together, to worship him, to bring him praise, and to bless his name. So we're going to do that this morning. Father, we thank you so much for our time together. Thank you for the opportunity to be with your people and to worship and anticipate what is to come. But Father, we thank you so much for the blessings of the things that we have right now in this life, in this moment. And we pray that our words that we sing, and the voices that we lift up would be pleasing to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name.
Come on, sing it out.
Sing like never before. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, can I run from your presence? Where can I flee from you? Even if I lie in the lowest valley, you will find me there. Deeper than any ocean, your love goes on and on and on.
For singing along with us. Won't you please be seated this time?
This morning, there we go. This morning we'll be reading from Acts chapter 5, verses 17 through 21 and 29 through 32. The high priest and his officials who were Sadducees were filled with jealousy. They arrested the apostles and put them in public jail. But an angel of the Lord came at night, opened the gates of the jail, and brought them out. Then he told them, "Go to the temple and give the people this message of life." So at daybreak, the apostles entered the temple, and as they were told, and immediately began teaching. When the high priest and his officials arrived, they convened with the high council and the full assembly of the elders of Israel. Then they were sent for the apostles to be brought from the jail for trial. When Peter and the apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead after you killed him, by hanging him on the cross. Then God put him in the place of honor at his right hand as a prince and savior. He did this so that the people of Israel would repent of their sins and be forgiven. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, who is given by God to those who obey him."
Thank you, Hunter, for reading the scripture for us this morning. We are in Acts chapter 5. I invite you to go there this morning. We're not going to be using the screen as much for what we find in Acts 5. If we are outside of that portion of scripture, we'll include that on the screen. Anybody have a hard time waking up this morning? Anybody forget to set their clock? That's why we have second service. If you forget to set your clock, you're right on time for second service. Mary Mohammi lives in Iran, and as a young girl, she was training to be a gymnast, but injuries prohibited her from pursuing her career. She wanted to stay involved with the sport, so she became a trainer at a local gym. As a child, she always had a curiosity about God and religion. So when she was 17, she began to do research about God, and she obtained her own secret copy of the Bible through a friend, even though it was illegal. An Iranian pastor living overseas began to correspond with her, helping her through her questions. In the course of time, Mary became a follower of Jesus. She said, "In the gospel, I have found truth, love, life, forgiveness, humanity, and peace. Whatever is necessary to make this world a better place is found in the gospel of Jesus Christ." In 2017, at the age of 19, she was arrested and sentenced to 6 months in prison for being a Christian. She has been released and arrested twice since then. She was barred from her job. She's blocked from going back to the university. January the 18th of this very year, she was detained by the morality police in Iran for dressing inappropriately. They took her to the detention center where a year earlier she had also been detained, stripped, abused, and held her for another hour and a half. How do you stay determined to follow Jesus when we live in a dangerous, difficult world? Leah Serabu is from Nigeria. Leah was one of the 100 plus girls that were studying at a local technical school 3 years ago. You may remember the story, some from the Boko Haram terrorist group came down upon the premises of that tech school. They stole over 100 girls, packed them into the back of a truck, and took them away without mercy. Four or five of the girls died in the back of the truck as they whisked them away from the scene. About a month later, they freed nearly all of those girls but one, Leah. Why? Because the rest were Muslims, but she was a Christian. She refused to renounce her faith in Christ. 1 year later, a voice recording was discovered from her, pleading for help from her government and people of well-being. A year later, her mother came to the United States, to Washington, D.C., seeking political help from our government. Not too long ago, it was reported that she had been impregnated by a leader of the sect, but it was unverifiable. It's been 3 years. How do you remain determined to follow Jesus in a dangerous, difficult world? David Bile is an American-Canadian pastor who lived for 19 years in Turkey. He raised his family, established his home there. He boldly and consistently talked about the gospel with his friends. But in recent days, authorities instructed him he had 15 days to get out of the country. He was called a security threat and permanently banned from the country. Francis Chan is a name that many of you recognize, an American author, pastor. He decided to move to Hong Kong to initiate his ministry from that part of the world. In January of this year, he reported, "Officials have rejected our visas. We have to leave the country. We are now back in the United States appealing the decision, hope to get back to Hong Kong soon, but the probability is very slim as communist China continues to have increasing presence in Hong Kong." How do you stay determined to follow Jesus in a dangerous, difficult world? That's why we have Acts chapter 8. It's here in this chapter that we find incentive to stay faithful to Jesus, even when things happening around us are not that easy. You remember that we started in Acts chapter 1, and the believers at that time were simply trying to fulfill the ministry that Jesus had begun as he taught and did what we are to do. In Acts chapter 1:8, Jesus told his disciples, "And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and all the way to the ends of the earth." And that's what the believers were attempting to do. Things were going rather well. The group was multiplying in number. The expansion was happening. And then we hit Acts chapter 4. There's resistance to the movement. Several weeks ago, we saw Acts chapter 4. Peter and Silas were arrested, incarcerated, held overnight. They got out. They were told, "If you speak anymore in Jesus' name, we're going to put you back in jail." Acts chapter 5, the church is purged of hypocrisy. We saw that last Sunday. But now we come to the second part of Acts chapter 5, and we see more resistance. Here in this chapter, we see the 12 apostles detained. Now it's not just Peter and John. Now it's all 12 are thrown into jail because they continue to preach in the name. How do you stay determined? Steve Addison, who wrote the book, What Jesus Started, Joining the Movement and Changing the World, says this: Jesus promised his disciples three things. Number one, they would be completely fearless. Number two, they would be unbelievably happy. And number three, they would constantly be in trouble. How can we stay determined, and how did they stay determined? That's what we want to unpack as we come to Acts chapter 5. We'll look at some of the principles that undergirded them in a very challenging environment, and we hope to give encouragement to you as well. The first thing that becomes very clear to us as we get into Acts chapter 5, verse 17 and following, was the role that persecution plays in a movement. Perhaps there is nothing that is more misunderstood by the American church than the role of suffering in the cultivation of our own faith and the propagation of the faith of Christ. God uses suffering more than anything else to mature our faith. We balk at that, but there's profound truth in the role of adversity in our life. Ask any coach, they know that it's the adversity that builds muscle. God's word reveals some 50 healthy purposes for difficulty in our walk of faith. Of course, the enemy has a purpose as well. You know what the enemy's purpose is in adversity? To keep us quiet. He wants to silence us. Jesus had already told his disciples that there would be some difficult times ahead, and so this was not a surprise to them. You may remember back in John 15, Jesus, in his huddle with his disciples, said these words: "If the world hates you, keep in mind it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember the words I spoke to you: no servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also." And then in John 16, he closes that thought with these final words: "I've told you this so that when the time comes, you'll remember that I warned you." So when this happens to the apostles, they're not caught off guard. They're not caught unawares. And Jesus reminds us in the very same way that we can anticipate difficulty if we're walking with Jesus. Do you remember how the Sermon on the Mount closes? "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake," for what? Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Paul reminded us in 2 Timothy 3:12, he said, he says this, "Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will," what? "Be persecuted." There will be some challenge. There will be some resistance. And so we understand this background as we see what's about to happen with the apostles. Let's follow along. Luke's record begins in verse 17 as we see this account. Verse 17 of Acts 5. "Then the high priest and all the associates who were members of the party of the Sadducees were filled with jealousy. They arrested the apostles, put them in public jail, but during the night an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail and brought them out. Go stand in the temple courts, he said, and tell the people all about this new life. Isn't it amazing what the angel tells these guys to do? Don't run and hide. That's not what he said. Don't flee the country. Be calm. Be safe. That's not the message he gives. But rather go back to the very place where they had been arrested and continue to speak the message of this new life. Who are the Sadducees or the Sanhedrin? The Sanhedrin was basically made up of the Sadducees. And maybe for lack of a better word, but to simplify it, they were the theologically very liberal people of that day. They didn't believe in anything that was supernatural. They didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in demons. They didn't believe in the resurrection from the dead. And they oversaw the temple and the interpretation of the law. They were caught in an age-old dilemma between living truth and dead tradition. The religious lost. There are people who are very religious but yet lost, and they represented that group. They were powerful, they were wealthy, and they were the first to resist the movement. What were they filled with? Jealousy. They were losing followers, and Christ was gaining them, and they arrested the apostles and put them in public jail. This is now the second time the apostles get put into jail. This time it's all 12, not just two. Hugh Latimer, who was himself burned at the stake in the 1500s by Bloody Mary, had this to say: whenever you see persecution, there's more than a probability the truth is on the persecuted side. Verse 19 and 20 tell us that this angel of the Lord stepped into the jail cell and said, go, take your stand, and tell the people the full message of this new life. What a great reminder of your mission and mine. That's it, verse 20. God wants this message to leave this building. He wants this message to go into our community. He wants to do it through you, and he wants to do it through me. And incidentally, this is the first of three prison escapes that happen in the book of Acts. God knows how to get us out of jail. He knows how to get us out of these difficult things if that's his desire. But I think the most humorous thing about this story up to this point is God's humor. Do you notice what God uses to get the apostles out of the jail? An angel. What was the very thing the Sadducees didn't believe in? Angels. And so God, in his own way, kind of in an ironic, humorous way, uses an angel to get these guys out. Well, they didn't even believe in angels. Remember, he knows how to get you out of your difficulties as well. But this is one more hammer blow at the conscience of the Sanhedrin. A reminder, there is an all-powerful working God. Verse 21, at daybreak, they entered the temple courts as told and began to teach the people. The Pharisees and the Sadducees and those on the Sanhedrin didn't even realize these guys were out of jail. They went to bed and slept that night, thought everything was normal. And then they went looking for these men who they had jailed. They don't find them until several verses later. We move down to verse 28, and you can follow along in your version of the scripture as well. Verse 28, we gave you strict orders not to teach in his name. Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood. Notice the double accusation. You have filled what? Jerusalem. With this teaching. Would to God that our enemies would say the same thing of us. Man, those small groups, they're just multiplying. I mean, all 25 townships of Licking County, we have people that are meeting to learn more from God's word, encourage each other. Wouldn't that be an awesome accusation? All 88 counties of the state of Ohio, boy, you're just taking it by storm. You're filling our neighborhoods. You're filling our schools. You're filling our cities and our towns with the teaching of Jesus. They were getting it done. Psalm 76:10 says that the wrath of man will praise him. God has a way of circumventing man's wrath for his glory. They also say, don't teach in this name. You are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood. Do you notice something that they don't want to say? They don't want to say whose name. There's so much animosity built up. They don't even want to say the name of Jesus. It's kind of ironic. They say, you're trying to make us guilty of this man's blood. Do you remember what happened just weeks earlier at the crucifixion? Pilate pulls out a basin of water, washes his hand, and says, I'm not guilty. And they cried out saying, may his blood be on our heads and on our children. Now they don't want to admit it. You're trying to make us guilty of this man's blood. Well, if you and I are to remain determined to love and follow Jesus in a dangerous and difficult world, be encouraged that Jesus has already told us there will probably be difficult times on occasion in life. The apostles were braced and ready. This didn't take them by surprise. They faced persecution well. As they faced the adversity, notice the determination and the persistence as they worked through this challenge. Verse 29, Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than man, rather than human beings. Some translations, and perhaps yours says the same, we ought to obey God. Anybody have that translation? That probably is a little weak, but what that word suggests is we have a moral obligation to obey God. So the word must is perhaps even more accurate. You may be thinking in your mind, well, we just recently finished the book of Romans. What about Romans 13, 1? Therefore, everyone must be subject to governing authorities. Is that not true? Well, there's great truth in that. Until the governing authorities tell us to not do what God tells us to do or to do what God doesn't command us to do. In other words, friends on the Sanhedrin, there is a higher court in this land than you. Somebody sent my wife a picture this week on her phone of a church somewhere in this country, and it had a sign out front, and it simply said this: if you want God to bless America, stop legalizing sin. In short, this is a very clear statement for us, perhaps one of the greatest statements in all of Scripture. We must obey God rather than man. What a great motto to live by. Might be a motto that you put on your cell phone, put on a mirror, in the bathroom, on the dashboard, a reminder. Painted up on a wall in the house. We must obey God rather than man. It's a great truth not only to live by, but it's a greater truth to die by. That makes death pretty easy when that's been your motive in life. Well, this put the Sanhedrin in a predicament. Who did the Sanhedrin think they were? God's representatives to Israel. But obviously, Peter is ranking up the bar a little bit higher. You remember that angelic message that came to the apostles when the prison door opened up? Verse 20, going backwards, the angel said to them, go take your stand and tell the people the full message of this new life. And watch this progression. God first sends his son into the world. Then he sends his spirit into the world. And now he's sending us into the world. We have purpose. We have a vision. And Peter identifies very closely with his crowd. He says, the God of our predecessors. Listen, guys, we came from the same stock. And then he points to the resurrection, as every sermon does in the book of Acts. That God raised this guy from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. What's Peter doing? He's just sharing the gospel with these people. I heard a funny story this past week about a soldier. He was new in the army, and they were teaching him how to march. They stood at attention for some time, but suddenly, while he was standing there in attention, he looked over to the spectators in the crowd, and he waved. The drill instructor went to the young man, and he growled, "Soldier, don't you ever do that again." But as the company marched past the reviewing stand, he waved the second time. When the troops got back to the barracks, the sergeant went to his private. He barreled in and barked at the soldier. He said this, "Listen, I told you not to wave. Aren't you afraid of me?" And the private said, "Yes, sir, but you don't know my mother." Do you know Jesus? Do you know the deep love that he has for you? You don't know my Jesus. I like what Charles Stanley used to say. He would simply say this: here's the basic laws of life. Obey God and leave the consequences to him. That's what these guys are doing. Verse 30, we continue. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. Verse 31, God exalted him to his own right hand as prince and savior that he might bring Israel what? To repentance, to a turning of the heart, to a new life, and the forgiveness of sins. Verse 32, we are witnesses of these things. So is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. Did you notice there in verse 32, who gets the Holy Spirit? Those who go to church, those who read the Bible, those who listen, or those who obey? And it's in that obedience that God floods our hearts with his presence. So you see this persistence, even though life was challenging and they pushed through the pain. We get to the final section, the final incentive that helps us, and that's just simply surrendering ourselves to the providence of God. When we talk about providence, we're not talking about a city in Rhode Island. We're talking about the loving care of a good God. How does God intervene in this circumstance? Verse 33. When they heard this, they were furious. We're talking about the Sanhedrin. They wanted to put them to death. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law who was honored by all the people, stood up in the Sanhedrin and ordered that the men be put outside for a little while. Then he addressed the Sanhedrin, "Men of Israel, consider carefully what you intend to do with these men. Some time ago, Theudas appeared, claiming to be somebody, and about 400 men rallied to him. He was killed, all of his followers were dispersed, and it all came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean appeared in the days of the census and led a band of people in revolt. He too was killed, and all of his followers were scattered. Therefore, in the present case, I advise you, leave these men alone. Let them go, and listen to these words, for if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourselves fighting against God." And we step back from that and you say, whoa, where did this guy come from? Who is Gamaliel? Well, Gamaliel, you've heard of the Apostle Paul, who's not appeared in the Luke story of the early church yet. But Gamaliel was the mentor, the coach, the teacher that was training Paul before he came to know Christ. He steps in the nick of time and inevitably saves the apostles of what could have been their end of ministry. Isn't it intriguing how God will often place somebody ironically and strategically in your life and mine to help us through those difficult challenges? You remember Joseph? The Bible story just reflects this over and over and over again. Joseph in the book of Genesis, where would he have been had it not been for Pharaoh? What about Daniel in Babylon? God used Nebuchadnezzar to give Daniel a platform. Nehemiah rebuilt the walls with the help of whom? King Artaxerxes. The Jews were allowed back into the promised land by the gracious gift of a king named Cyrus of Persia. Proverbs 21:1 says, "The king's heart is in the Lord's hand, and he directs it like a water course where he wishes." The kings today, their hearts are in the Lord's hands. God is sovereign. His providence intervenes. Yet Gamaliel's advice is really a half-truth. If this activity is of God, you'll not be able to stop it. And that is true. You'll only find yourself fighting against God. But the other half of this advice is a half-truth. In essence, they're saying, if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. Well, sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. Are you aware of any religious cults or sects that have endured for decades and centuries, even false religions that have lasted through much of the history of time? So really what he's saying is only a half-truth. Verse 40, his speech persuaded them. They called the apostles in, had them flogged. And incidentally, that word flogged is the same word that they would use when you skin an animal. They flogged them. Then they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Now, this flogging was not the Roman flogging with the cat of nine tails. It was a Jewish version that was a little bit easier. It hurt, but it wasn't life-threatening. And then they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. And we have in verse 41, do you think they stayed quiet? Do you think that slowed it down? The apostles left the Sanhedrin rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Day after day in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Messiah. These guys were dignified by this indignity. They just kept on going. They pursued the prize. How do you keep loving Jesus and following him in a dangerous, difficult world? Well, I think this story will hopefully give us some encouragement. These guys were at it. They were doing it. And they give us encouragement. And hopefully you'll see from this story the role that persecution and adversity can play in the cultivation of some of the deeper virtues of character. It's not all about just being comfortable and at peace, but sometimes we've got to go to the battle. Maybe you'll see this morning the persistence when life was hard. We must obey God rather than man. And then you see God's intervening hand of providence. A week ago on Friday night, we had some friends over, and we were watching a live stream of the Voice of the Martyrs radio broadcast, and they were showing some stories of people in life today that are going through some of the most adverse circumstances. One of the individuals that they highlighted that evening was a man by the name of Dan Bauman. As we wrap things up this morning, I'd like for us to watch this little news clip on Dan's life and then pull this story together as we apply it to our lives today.
It's the devotion to his Christian faith that took a young man from California all the way to Afghanistan. After first volunteering and working at an eye hospital, Dan Bauman then set his own sights on neighboring Iran. And in 1997, what was supposed to be a two-week trip turned into a nine-week nightmare as a prisoner of the Iranian Islamic regime.
In my walk with the Lord and in many dangerous places, I've always seen God come through. And all of a sudden, the thought hit me, well, what if this is different?
Iran's government falsely charged him with spying and for being a missionary, charges that carried two separate death sentences.
It was out of my hands. There was nothing I could do. Either God would do a miracle or I would stay there.
He writes about his experience in a book called Cell 58. Alone in a small dark room, his only interaction, interrogations and beatings by prison guards. Broken and afraid, Dan decided his only escape was to take his own life.
Four times I tried to kill myself, but every time I tried, I was too scared to tie the other end.
In his final failed attempt, Dan had a vision that broke the despair.
And I remember lying down on the ground in that moment, all of a sudden the room fills with this glorious light. And I turn around to see what's going on, and there is Jesus. And it was at that lowest point that he met me.
The turnaround provided hope, an ability to keep going, and strength to forgive and even befriend the guard who regularly beat him. It also gave him the courage to boldly proclaim his faith in front of his accusers and an Iranian judge.
And for about 20 minutes, I just preached the gospel. And I told everyone in that courtroom, and I told everyone who could hear me, all about who Jesus is, all about how much he loved him. All of a sudden, I realized something. I am free. I am free. So what if they kill me? My life is bought by the blood of Jesus. My home is in heaven, and no one can take that away.
Following that news clip, Dan came on the stage and he told just a little bit more the details of what it was like to be incarcerated in Iran. He said this, "Without fail, every day for 9 weeks, I was blindfolded and beaten by the same prison guard. One day," he said, "as I went into the beating, I heard the Holy Spirit say, 'I want to teach you, Dan, how to love your enemies.' Dan said, 'God, this isn't a good time to teach me how to love my enemies. You know who this guy is that just keeps beating the tar out of me? Do you know how much abuse and how much hatred and anger there is in this place? Not a good time.'" He stopped and he said, "Well, God, how do I love him?" The Holy Spirit said, "Ask me what I think of him." God wanted to change the subject. "Ask me what I think of him." So I said, "Well, God, what do you think of him?" God says, "Listen, Dan, I have always loved this man. He just doesn't know it. I love him. I love his wife. I love his children. I know each of them by name. I love this man." Dan said, "You really love this man?" "Yeah, much more than you would ever know." Dan said, "Well, why don't you change my heart?" So that day, Dan decided that he would try to say good of this man who was tormenting him. He would bless him. Dan went on to say, "And I'll never forget that last day that I saw my tormentor." He said, "I walked in to the interrogation room. I looked at the floor. There was blood on the ground from the previous interrogation. And something happened." Dan said, "I looked into the face of this tormentor and I said, 'Sir, if I'm going to see you every day of my life from this day forward, could we be friends?' The guy shook his head. He said, 'What do you mean become friends? We'll never become friends.' Dan said, "Yeah, no, let's become friends. I mean, really. 'No, we'll never become friends,' was the reply. Dan said, 'No, today, let's see if we can't change this. Let's become friends.'" And Dan started by saying this, "Never once have you called me by name. I don't know your name." Dan was just referred to as number 58 because that was his jail cell. He said to his tormentor, "My name is Dan. What's your name?" The man stood there for a while, his hands were in his pocket, and suddenly his hands began to tremble. And his tormentor, as Dan had reached out his hand to say, "Could we become friends?" his tormentor began to take his hand out of his pocket, and it was trembling. And he reached out, and he took Dan's hand, and he squeezed Dan's hand, and he said, "Yes, I do want to be friends." Dan said inside, "I was thinking, yeah, I want him to be my friend too." And the next thing was unexplainable because in the Iranian culture, even just to shake someone's hand is a sign of friendship. But that man took him and pulled Dan in closer and he said, "My name is Rizal. I want to be your friend." And then he pulled Dan in close, and in that culture, he kissed him on the left cheek, the right cheek, and then onto the left cheek again. And they stood back. The tormentor went on, and he said, "Dan, I have to apologize to you because I don't make all the decisions in this place. I'm sorry. I do have a little word in some things that are done. Dan, if there's anything I can do to help you, do you have any requests? And Dan said, man, if you could get me a little larger prison cell, that would be really good. He was stuck in a 3x4. He said, I'll see what I can do. That was the last time he saw him. That night, they came in to get Dan. They took him to a larger cell, and then they gave him his civilian clothes back. Later that evening, he was put on a bus, sent to the border, and released. Freedom. Is it any wonder why Christianity is growing faster in Iran today than any other country in the world? 19 to 20% annual growth of people coming to meet Jesus. And I think it's because of people like Dan. How do you remain determined to follow Jesus in a dangerous and difficult world? Well, this morning, as we come to this moment, I don't know if you've noticed this, but every time we come to another message of the apostles in the book of Acts, the message is all about the forgiveness of sins. God wants to forgive our sins. But that message has got to get out. It's got to be told, and he wants to work through people like you and me. We have no peace in ourselves because we have no peace with our Maker. And until we have peace with our Maker, there will never be peace in our hearts. What God was doing through Dan, he has done for us through Jesus Christ. It was Christ who took his hand and extended it and said, could we be friends? The response is up to you and me. It was God who through Christ was reconciling the world back to himself. And it's Christ who extends his hand and said, sir, Mr., Mrs., young man, young woman, could we be friends today through the blood of Christ, which was shed for our forgiveness of sins? Right now, I'd like to invite you, as we wrap things up this morning, to take the emblems of the Lord's Supper. What a great time to remember how God, through Jesus, wants to offer us forgiveness of sins. We begin to take back the cover on the bread. We are reminded of a body that was broken. And we take the cup following, and of the blood that was shed so that we could have a clean conscience, so that we could have a new birth, a new start, and a new purpose in life. And it was the very words of Peter that summarize this act when he said, the God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. I was part of that. So were you. But God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior so that he might bring you and me to repentance, a change of heart, a new start, a new life, and the forgiveness of sins. As we conclude this time of reminding this covenant that we have with Christ, perhaps you're thinking, you know, I really need to have forgiveness. I need a new start. And we would love to have a conversation with you. You can do that very simply after we close with this time of worship. I'll be here, would be happy to have a conversation with you. We can have a conversation back at the connection point. We also have our in-church text phone number that you can text the word respond, and we can have a conversation that way, 740-303-7898. Would you hear the voice of the Lord inviting you back into a relationship with him? Let's worship the Lord. Stand with me and let's just worship the Lord as we close this way.
one of the ways that we work through difficulty, we work through the challenges that life brings, is knowing that God is present with us. One of the ways that we know that God is present with us is because His Word tells us. His Word gives us examples again and again, not only with the apostles in Acts, but going back from the beginning of time, where God is present with the Israelites. He's present with His faithful followers. And because we know God has been present in the past, we know that He's here in the future. But we also have that hope as we continue to look forward beyond today. So as you think about your struggles, as you think about the difficulties, as you think about the things that you're facing in life right now, the things that you're experiencing in the name of Jesus, know, number one, that those things are worthwhile. God's not going to use that in vain. But secondly, that God is present with us. We'll never be alone. There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, there's a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There's another in the fire. All my debt left for debt beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. And should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning, either way I won't bow to the things of this world. And I know I will never be alone. There's another in the fire standing next to me. There's another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding what power set me free? There's a grave that holds nobody. Now that power lives in me. There's another in the fire. And still is and will be through it all. So come what may in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. And I know I will never be alone. Be another in the fire standing next to me. Be another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding how good you've been to me? Count the joy from every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be.
standing next to me. Come on, another in the waters, holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding of how good you've been to me? I'll count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. There's another in the fire. Oh, there's another in the fire. Oh, there's another in the fire. Oh, there's another in the fire. Oh.
Amen. Friends, I hope that you are encouraged this week to live faithfully for the Lord as you leave this place, knowing there may be difficulties, there may be struggles, but the God above all things is with us, and he is with you as you leave today. Share the gospel with somebody this week and invite them back to be with us next week. Have a great week. Thanks for being here this morning.